Thank you. Ironically, one of the things I talk about tonight is stepping out of your comfort zone. And this is, I normally get to hide a little bit behind my keyboard, so I get to step forward a little bit tonight myself. So this is the last sermon of our series on blurred lines, sexuality and spirituality. So one of the reasons I'm speaking tonight is because of my involvement with the leather community. If you don't know, a large portion of the leather community and kink communities define themselves as very spiritual, even the ones that don't consider themselves to be religious. And after tonight, I'm hoping you will have some understanding why. I also want to talk about worship, that being my background. Have you ever really thought about worship? Why do we worship? Is it for God? Is it for us? We mostly think of worship as something for our soul. But tonight I want to start from the fact that worship happens in the body God gave you, and God says that body is good. Psalm 139, 13 to 14 says, "You are the one who put me together inside my mother's body, and I praise you because of the wonderful way you created me. Everything you do is marvelous, of this I have no doubt." This was actually a hard verse for me to hear as a kid. I was wiry, if not scrawny. I was a geek before it was popular. And a good self-image, yeah, who knew? I turned out to be an IT director. So for me, a good self-image was something I really had to work on. And it didn't help that I was surrounded by the idea that the spiritual is good, and I was brought up in a very spiritual and worshiping environment. So the physical and your body must be bad. It's not actually a new concept. Gnosticism has been around since about the first century and believes that the spiritual is good, therefore everything material is evil, including the body. The Gnostics split off from Christianity early on. Their writings were actually intentionally left out of the canon of the Bible by Christian leaders. But their influence remains through the Puritans up through their modern descendants. So keeping in mind that physical things are not bad or less holy, I want to take a look at what we do during worship. So let's list a few. You can sing, sway, clap, raise your hands. If you're really brave, you can dance. So now taking a closer look, you sing. Singing engages the very breath of your body. Working with your breath is one of the core parts of meditation. It relieves stress, it aids focus, affects your emotions, affects your mood. Singing will automatically correct your posture. That's also something that's been shown to affect your mood. Swaying, rhythmic motion, also a common meditation technique, affects your mood and your focus. Okay, so far so good. All right, we're going to move on to clapping. So if you describe this phenomenon as if you've never heard of it before, okay, you take both hands about shoulder width apart, smack them together as hard as you can so it makes a loud and annoying noise. Ow. So that kind of hurts your hands, it offends your ears, and yet it's a positive part of our worship. Raising your hands, all right. Anybody here come to worship after shoulder day at the gym? The words feel the burn sound familiar? Anybody who comes on Sunday and we have that beautiful part of our worship after communion where the congregation all holds hands and raises them together, and have you ever really wished that the preacher praying would get on with it so you can put your arms down because they're starting to ache a little bit, and yet they pray. And it's uncomfortable. And yet, despite that discomfort, that is one of about three elements of our Sunday worship that come up when we talk about defining moments in our worship as a congregation. So then there's dancing. We don't see that as much here, even on Wednesday night. But dancing is unashamedly physical. It is a part of contemporary worship in many churches. It involves pretty much every part of your body. It expends calories, elevates your heart rate, gets you out of breath, a little bit tired, but it feels good. So these are physical acts of worship. You do them with your body. And they aren't somehow made less holy because of that. In fact, they all serve to focus your attention on God and heighten your worship experience, despite the fact that some of them are at least temporarily uncomfortable. So how is it that uncomfortable things, some things even on the edge of pain, can bring a positive result in worship? Well, the same way they can in the rest of your life. The runners and cyclists and cardio enthusiasts here are pretty familiar with hearing about endorphins. They're natural brain chemicals the body releases often in response to pain or stress. But they reduce stress, they modify pain sensations, they boost the immune system, and in short, give us a reward for being physically active. Higher levels of endorphins, although they're not addictive like an opiate, but they can give a euphoric sensation. You often hear about the runner's high. It's a somewhat simplistic explanation. There's a lot more going on in your body, but suffice it to say, this is part of the body's built-in and amazing system. All right, so far we've talked about modern styles of worship. If you go back a bit, there are other wilder activities that have also been used to focus the attention on God. Go back to the Middle Ages, the monks that spend most of their lives withdrawing from the world. They believe that was holier and from sensation. But it comes to Lent and a session of penitence, flogging themselves to increase their level of holiness, pay for their sins. And it also led to such a rush of endorphins, they believed it brought them into the very presence of God. It's well enough known for Monty Python to poke some fun at it. They're chanting. Okay, so it's funny. It's Monty Python, which means it's at least partially funny. But to this day, in the Philippines, in parts of Spain, in various parts of the world, penitents flog themselves bloody, climb rocky mountains on their knees every Lent, for the same reasons and with some of the same results. Without modern tools and modern thought to understand them, ecstatic experiences have almost universally been interpreted as religious experiences. Catharsis, it's a Greek word, means the release and relief from strong and or repressed emotions. Many of us learn that word in studying theater, music, literature, as ways the audience can be led to a cathartic experience by the artistry of the words and or music. In addition, strong exertion, endorphins, and to some extent pain can produce the same result. So things that in other contexts would be uncomfortable and even painful sometimes make us feel good, even potentially ecstatic. And not only that, we do some of them in worship. So if these same things come up in your recreational life or your bedroom, why do we suddenly judge them as bad? I've mentioned I'm in leather. In fact, I am the current president of Discipline Corps, which is a local men's BDSM group. Relax. I've been about as shocking as I'm going to be tonight, and I'm not here to recruit you. But I do want to address the thinking that kink, S&M play, things that involve potentially pain or power exchange, is abusive or causes harm, and therefore nothing a good Christian could ever do. It is not the case. In fact, for this level of play to work at all, consensual S&M play in relationships require a deeper level of communication, negotiation, than many vanilla couples ever get around to. There's a deep connection that happens, which is not particularly surprising, because we're using some of the same physical tools that in worship we use to strengthen our connection with God. But because people are imperfect, I also want to show this slide, which gives some very clear-cut ways to tell the difference between kink and abuse. And please, if you are in an abusive situation or relationship, please get help, and get free from that abuse. And while I'm talking about getting help, we haven't said it yet in this series, but if you've reached a point in your life where your sex life is controlling you instead of you controlling your sex life, and it's causing problems with life decisions, family, or work, there are people you can reach out to get help to pull your life in balance. Not because sex is wrong, but to help you be in a balanced life. All right, so we started out talking about worship. We talked about some activities that help us in worship and a little bit about why they work. And then we talked about the connection with leather and kink. Now, I want to go back to worship. So earlier, if you notice, I kind of made the assumption that y'all were joining in with some of the clapping and the hand raising and all of that. Okay, not everybody does. Does that mean you're less holy? Absolutely not. Is this style of worship somehow better? No. Does it make you a better Christian? No. Will it give you a sense of release and freedom you haven't had for a while? Well, it could. Sometimes in Wednesday night, as we lead in worship for this group, there's a tension in the room because there are people that are worshiping and there are people that are worshiping and they're so close to stepping the next step forward in worship. If it's not your style and that's why you don't want to step over that line, that's okay. But if you're holding back in worship because you're afraid of what other people will think, if you're afraid you'll look foolish, or because you think physical expression is somehow less spiritual, I want to encourage you to step out. Be free. So here's your executive summary. Leather folk aren't evil. S&M is not about harm. Worship is kinky when you least expect it. And once again, and most important, Cathedral of Hope is a place that encourages us not to compartmentalize our lives. After all, we worship in the same body we have sex in. And that statement should be no more shocking than any other statement we make about our faith. If you're here to worship God, do it with all your heart, soul, and strength, and with all the tools God gave you, including the physical tools. And if you haven't fully expressed that yet, well, we're here every Wednesday night.